I walked into a doctor's office and the doctor said, HIPAA schmippa. How do I deal with that?
You're listening to the Help Me with HIPAA podcast, where HIPAA and humor collide to make learning fun. Your delightful hosts are Donna Grindle and David Sims. Relax, HIPAA help is on the way.
In today's episode, we're going to cover the new Ponemon study of 2014. And joining us, as always, is my favorite lady, Donna Grindle from Kardon Compliance. How are you doing today, Donna?
I'm doing fantastic. Glad to know I'm your favorite.
Yeah, don't tell my wife I said that. She might take offense.
Luckily, we get along.
Well, you know, keep your enemies close.
That sounds more like it.
So, tell us a little bit about this Ponemon study and what it means to healthcare compliance and companies.
You're basically saying, tell us about why we're talking about this thing that you want to talk about.
Why are we talking about this study? Yeah, why
Donna wants to talk about it. David has to give in. That's the way it works.
What is this? Tell us about it. What is it?
So, for the last 5 years, the Ponemon, am I saying it right? Ponemon?
Yeah.
Ponemon Institute has conducted a study of specifically of healthcare breaches at the end of each year. And so they just released in May their study from 2014 that took into account for the very first time not only covered entities but also business associates. So they had 90 covered entities and 88 business associates, and they gave them this huge questionnaire with all of these really interesting questions. And me being the math and IT, well, I'm just a nerd. I get all excited when they release things like this. So in their new study, for the first time since they started doing this, for the fifth study, for the first time, criminal attacks are the number one reason in the study for healthcare data breaches. Well, that's big news when you look at what people really have been involved in breaches dealt with, what we in a study would call employee negligence, but not like in a evil, negative sort of way. It's just, I didn't follow the rules, I made a mistake, I forgot, I lost my laptop, I left it in the car, it got stolen. Those kind of things fall under employee negligence. And that has always been, you know, a stolen laptop, a lost mobile device, those have been what we've talked about for years as the number one reason for breaches. And now criminal attacks fall in. So that's why I wanted to talk about it. Well, it's one of the many reasons I wanted to talk about it.
So this, I'm assuming, is the first time that business associates have been in this study.
Correct. Now, because, you know, 2013 is when the rules changed to officially make business associates be part of HIPAA compliance or equally and separately responsible for compliance. So they hadn't done it until 2014 would be the first full year that business associates were supposed to be tracking things.
Right. And I'm sure that definitely changed the outcome of the data.
Well, they did a good job, you know, breaking it down and giving you this is what the business associate said, and this is what the covered entity said, and this is what the data was as a whole. So you could see there were slight variances between the two, but overall, the numbers are generally the same. It's not like one has one problem and the other has a different problem. Mm-hmm. And that's why the criminal attacks issue was such a big deal, because it covers not just criminal attacks like hackers like you think about, but also internal criminal attacks. So not an employee negligent, but an employee actually is involved, actively involved in stealing your data. That kind of criminal attack.
Is it looking at business associates as far as their own security incidents or breaches, or is it looking at like a covered entity had a breach, but it was caused by a business associate, or does it include all that?
No, I think it's looking at what's happened in each individual organization, not tied together so much.
Okay.
Maybe some data in there, but the big instance is what's causing the breach in your individual organization.
Okay. So I guess there's a couple of things we probably need to define before we get into this study. And one of those things would be, what is a security incident?
Right. So the security incident means something went wrong, but as far as we know, nothing got into the wrong hands. So somebody tried to break in. We could see them breaking in. They got a little ways in, but they never got any further. So we know that nothing really got breached, but something did happen. Mm-hmm. Or we caught somebody trying to do this and stopped them before they were able to get to what they're after, is essentially what you're looking at.
And then the other thing is an actual data breach. So what?
That's when things get in the wrong hand. That's very bad.
We don't want no breaches.
Yeah, but no breaches. You knew that was coming.
We don't. Yeah, no breaches. We have no breaches.
See, now that just creates an entirely interesting, you know, you always see the stories about the radio and TV people where they wear their jacket and then they're wearing shorts or boxers under the table. So you're telling people we ain't got no breaches.
We have no breaches.
We have no breaches. But a data breach is the bad thing, and that's when things are in the wrong hands or you cannot be sure they are in the right hands. So if you can't be certain you know where it is and that it hasn't been attacked, then guess what? It is a breach.
Easy enough.
Right. So you look at the five-year study or the studies over 5 years, and not only has it transitioned to criminal attacks being the number one thing, but also it's the fact that all breaches, whether it's criminal attacks or the employee negligence or whatever those may be, over the five-year period, up 125% since they started checking.
Wow.
Now, part of that may be directly related to the fact that people didn't understand what a breach was as much 5 years ago. So when they were asked if they had one, they said, oh, no, that never happens to us.
Mm-hmm.
And then they went, oh, wait, that's what that means?
Yeah.
Ethel, where
now, is this study also based on, you know, people being truthful? I mean, could they say, oh, no, we haven't had a breach, but they have?
You know, it's like any other study.
Okay.
But it's anonymous as far as what they release or what they know, and they're not going to bring in any kind of law enforcement or anything or turn anybody in.
Yeah.
Is the intent.
But it is human nature not to tell on yourself too. So right. This number could be a lot higher than it really is.
Yeah. To fudge the truth, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And so while they're talking with you, as you talk about that, so when they look at the percentage of breaches, it's number one, but the security into themselves. So maybe you'll admit to a security incident, but not so much to a breach. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So then when we look at the security incidents, 78% of security incidents are for covered entities are related to criminal attacks, 82% of business associates. So if you say that, let's say that we know something happened and we're going to admit something happened because we think these numbers are important, but maybe not say it's a breach. That makes the numbers even more scary because that's saying that of all the things that we have going wrong, a lot of it has to do with criminal attack.
Mm.
And that we're having multiple ones because in the exposure time, if you would, then it's not only have I had one, but have I had multiple ones, and that number keeps going up. So you can't just sit around and say, well, if this happens, it's when this happens.
Right.
You know, there's no longer, you just can't live in the world where you think that maybe this could happen to us, but it won't because we're X, we're too small. It won't happen to us because we only have a couple of computers. It won't happen to us because we only use the cloud. It won't happen to us because, you name it, people have that feeling of it's never going to happen to me. And mm-hmm. you can ask any number of people, and you know, even the ones that say, well, it's not going to happen to me because we only have one computer. Well, then you probably have a lot of paper, and it can happen to you with paper too. Yes. So then you talk about, why are these criminal attacks going up? Well, the numbers show something like less than a dollar for identity theft for like credit card data, you know, and they go after Target and they get thousands and millions of credit card data. But mm-hmm. you can get for a medical identity like $75 a piece. So let's me get 1,000 of those and sell them two or three times.
Wrong business.
Yeah, or not.
Golly. Yeah, that's quite a bit different.
Yeah, I don't even know what the number is anymore. I can't even recall what they quoted exactly. It could be even more than $75. I don't know. It could be $1,500. It's a big number compared to the 75 cents or a dollar that they can get for a credit card. Mm-hmm. So that's number one. And number two, it's just so data rich. There's so many other things, and they know that. And you know, they're holding on to this data for years. It's not like they get it, they sell it, they don't have it anymore. They have it. It's theirs. And in a lot of cases, people are waiting because they know that this, I've had a breach and I'm going to give you
1 year monitoring.
1 year monitoring. So they hang on to it for a year or two before they start releasing it. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of cases where that occurs. And so there's breaches where your information was stolen 2 years ago. It's going to start coming out now. And people even forget that their information was stolen 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. So needless to say, there's so many things that can happen with it. And when you get the medical identity and you put into the fact that the medical identity theft itself, so not only are they stealing it, but they're actually using it to take on the identity of someone else and get medical care or their records so they know that they can't get past such and such because they have drug issues, they'll go get themselves tested and get a test that says they're nice and clean because they're using somebody else's information. You know, it's that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. I need a copy of such and such. Oh, okay. Well, here's your information. But the fact that that has almost doubled in the last 5 years, just the ones where we know the victims existed, where people have reported it, we know it's going on, that just means we've identified them. 2.3 million people in 2014. That's, you know, a massive amount of people. And then you add to it that studies have shown that those people are reporting that over $13,000 out of their pocket to deal with it. Because I always say you can cancel a credit card. How do you cancel your medical records? Go ahead, try it.
Yeah. And who's got $13,000 to deal with it? I mean, God, that's crazy.
Yeah, you could buy a couple of different air conditioning units for your house for that.
For those listening, that was a jab at me because my air conditioning unit went out today. And I've got to pay to have it replaced. I appreciate that, Donna, as I'm sitting in an 84-degree room.
Maybe there's a breeze outside.
Yeah, so I need to go start mining some medical data.
That's it. FBI will be knocking at your door next.
Yeah, I feel like I'm in Key West today.
Yeah, you're joking. It's hotter in Atlanta than it is in Key West. Trust me. Mm-hmm. I'm certain of this. So back to our topic of the day, those points that it was talking about of the, you know, we still have employee negligence and everybody needs to be concerned about that because that has been the problem for years. And it's just dropped to number two. So it's not like all of a sudden it's off the list. But the fact that the criminal attacks are rising so rapidly, that tells us that we need to do a better job across the board in making sure that the technical and the physical and the administrative safeguards that are built into HIPAA are in place and that the activity is being monitored mm-hmm. properly. It's not just, you know, it's that, oh, you know, you get that call. If I take your class, will that make me HIPAA compliant? No!
No.
You know, it's just not going to happen. So when you look at the things that we need to be doing, and you and I talk about them in a lot of our different episodes and our classes and webinars and whatever we're doing, the issue is it needs to be ongoing and you have to stay on top of it. And it really doesn't matter what business you run. any kind of business has to worry about this stuff today. You know, a law firm has to worry about this stuff just the same way as a medical office or an accounting firm or an IT company. Everybody should be worrying about it. And there are a lot of things being done trying to get people to worry about it. But we all know what it does to, you know, you can talk to 10 people and two of them might listen. Mm-hmm. And our listeners, they're the good ones. They're the ones that care.
Well, of course.
Yes.
I mean, they do, honestly, because they wouldn't even take the time to listen to this if it wasn't something that they cared about addressing, which is great because we see so many people out there who, what was that? Somebody emailed me the other day. I walked into a doctor's office and the doctor said, HIPAA schmippa. How do I deal with that was the question. Oh, yeah. Man. And that's crazy. But, you know, my opinion, and you may agree or disagree, but my opinion is patient care starts with caring for their medical records, not, you know, taking their blood pressure and seeing what's wrong with them. It starts with their medical records.
Well, it's no longer about HIPAA. It's about privacy and security of your patient's data that you are being entrusted with.
Mm-hmm.
It's about privacy and security and taking care of your patients. Just like you said, it's about privacy and security, taking care of patients. How many times can we say that? And that is the whole message. We just don't even talk about HIPAA anymore, even though our title of this show, Help Me With HIPAA, is designed for people that actually get that they need to do it. It really should be Help Me With Privacy and Security.
Mm-hmm.
Because all the concepts that we're talking about, the only difference between what healthcare people need to do and what any other business needs to do is that HIPAA has very specific documentation requirements and an enforcement arm that is being conducted somewhat against those requirements to say, are you actually doing what you're supposed to do?
Mm-hmm.
Other people should be doing basically the same thing. And if you look at the National Institutes for Standards and Technology, released last year a national cybersecurity framework for all businesses. And it's almost verbatim of HIPAA without the requirements of proving you're doing it.
Right. And we shouldn't, I say we, as compliance people and IT people, we shouldn't really have to be convincing customers and clients to be doing this stuff. It should really be second nature. You should be securing that data and you should be looking at privacy, especially in today's technology and today's world, the way things are. It shouldn't have to be something we convince you to do. And I think that's part of what HIPAA does, and it drives certain people crazy, is that they're telling you, you've got to do these things, and because you won't do it, we're going to fine you.
Yeah.
But it's, you know, you really shouldn't have to have a law or a governing body to do anything to get you to do this. It should be things that every business, like you said, every business should be doing this stuff anyway.
Well, HIPAA used to have the voluntary compliance. It used to have it. And clearly, no Didn't one work. Did it. They thought HIPAA schmippa.
HIPAA schmippa.
And they still do. And look where it got us. That's where it got us. That, okay, well, it's voluntary. It's really best practices. It's mm-hmm. business best practices. And they're not following it, and that's why it had to have enforcement, because the more you put online, clearly, the more it's open to attacks than you ever were before. So we have a growing amount of data online. We have a growing amount of awareness of the lack of concern for security, which is like a criminal, you know, it's like, woohoo, you're leaving your door open. I'm going to go looking for you. I mean, it's just, you can't just say HIPAA schmippa anymore. So that's why we try not to even say the word, because they relate it to something that people talked about that never turned into anything. Well, it never turned into anything because you elected not to do what you were supposed to do.
Yeah. It does shock me still that some of them have no idea that it's changed.
Yeah.
And I've walked into some covered entity. I understand with business associates because it's kind of new, but I've walked into some doctor's offices and they're like, no, we don't do anything with HIPAA. We don't have to, really.
Yeah.
Okay. And I just, with all that I see around the word and the law HIPAA, I just can't imagine that doctor's offices and dentists and chiropractors, whatever you want to category you want to put them in. I can't imagine they're not as inundated about it as I am. And I'm primarily in the IT industry and I see it all the time. I see HIPAA every single day. I don't see how they're not knowing that
covered entities. Covered entities have ignored it since 2003. So that's why they don't see it, because they've been ignoring it so long, they're not going to see it. That's when we don't talk about it anymore. We just talk about privacy and security. So the other point, and by the way, in the study was, it was across the board, it didn't matter what size organization you had. The statistics were the same. So small ones, large ones, didn't matter.
Yep. So that throws out the whole argument that I'm too small to worry about it.
Right. It didn't matter what size you were going to be attacked, period. You've got data. And most small practices, okay, let's say you have 100 patients. Okay, that is still a wealth of information. And they just don't see it that way. They don't understand it. And what's unfortunate is when you look at the numbers of the actual cost once you had the breach and you're dealing with what it cost you, and it's not just fines. The fines often end up being just a minute part of what the costs are. It's the legal fees. It's the amount of time that your staff and yourself can't do your normal jobs because you're caught up in this breach. It's the amount of time after the fact that you're going to have to continue to manage all of that information and what has occurred. It's the cost that you have on any corrective action plan you may be put on, and your reputation. You may lose some of those patients that you had before. So it's a massive amount of cost that has to be included when you look at, oh, it's $150,000, I'll write a check. No, you can't do that anymore. And that's the way some of these practices looked at it. Well, when you look at it now and say that the average cost of a data breach for a covered entity, so the healthcare organizations, the average cost is $2.1 million.
Holy cow.
So let's say you're below average.
This is one time when I want to be a below average person.
Right. I just want to be below average, but still below average. Now, business associates, it was like $1 million. Oh, that makes me feel much better.
I'll cut a check tomorrow. You
know, even below average of that, still not good enough.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So it's not something to play around with anymore, and it's not something to ignore anymore. And getting people, once they start to really evaluate and understand how far off the mark they are and how bad things really are in their business, no matter what kind of business it is, once they start to realize it and realize how much they're putting their patients or their customers' patients in danger, they often, I won't say always, but they often start to realize it is about privacy and security and I should take this seriously. But if you can't even get them to let you show them how bad it is, how poorly a job they're doing, it just really doesn't matter. You can't change them until they, you know, it's like everybody else. When something happens in their neighborhood, then they might pay attention and put in a security system.
You have to admit you have a problem before you can get help.
Well, and you know that maybe we should have some sort of therapy group for those who don't believe that they need to do security. We'll just, you know, have
HIPAA 12-step program.
Yeah. So it does show. Now, the good news is the study does show that slowly people are changing. The budgets are increasing, where they actually put budgets on the line item. There's a line item for security. Wow. I know that I still struggle to get them to say your budget should have a line item for technology just by itself.
Mm-hmm.
No, we just get a computer when we need one. There's my problem. You don't know when you're going to need one. You don't make a plan. And that's what we all talk about, a business plan. Well, you got a plan for how you're going to handle this and how you're going to buy this new piece of gizmo that you're going to use for treating patients, but you're going to use an old Windows XP computer to run it. Why are you doing that? You know? And so the good news is, while things are bad and while we still have an issue, clearly the constant barrage that you mentioned, maybe not about HIPAA, but about data breaches, and the cost of them and the civil suits and the lie, you know, there's just so much effect that a single breach can have, no matter how many patients are involved. So it's starting to change the landscape slowly but surely, where people are saying, hey, I better invest in this. And this is not, this is an investment in protecting your business. It is like, you know, getting locks on the doors and having a building that the roof won't fly off and those kind of things, and insurance policies. Those are, that's the kind of cost this is. It's just not something that you're throwing money at. It's something you need to invest in. Right. So
it's no longer, and this is one thing that I've actually started changing in our business, is that we're no longer saying that we're an IT company or an IT support company. We're now telling people that we're a risk management company that uses IT and compliance to manage those risks and reduce those risks that a company has.
Exactly. You can't talk about the same old things anymore. And people don't need, we don't need to be talking about them, because people don't need to be looking at them that way, because they've ignored those things for so long.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you can only ignore them for a certain amount of time before it will bite you. It's the fair, the what is it? The feed and caring. You must feed and care for it. Feed me, Seymour. Feed me. No, not. You don't get that movie.
I got it.
You just don't like it.
I'm still letting all the information from the study kind of soak in, because it.
Yeah.
I mean, it does almost sound very kind of dismal. I mean, that, you know, so many bad things are happening, but, you know, that just goes to show that the reliance on compliance professionals or IT professionals who are HIPAA compliant, or, you know, developing your training plan. And I mean, all these things that we talk about in every episode are so crucial to reduce that exposure to that average $2.1 million fine or $2.1 million estimate. I mean, if you walked into a business and said, look, for $5,000 a year, I can, you know, drastically reduce your chances of losing $2.1 million. They would listen.
Yeah.
But if you walk in and say, for $5,000 a year, we're going to do compliance, they're going, oh, no, that's all right. We're good. We got it.
Hippa-schmippa.
Yeah. Oh, man.
You know, of course, I then go to the end of the study where they actually give you, here's the questions, the actual questions we ask, because I am one of those kind of nerds where when I read, you know, 87% of people think McDonald's is the best hamburger, I want to know what question you actually ask those 87% of the people. You know, I want to know what was the question. Where were you? How did you find those people? So I actually go read where the numbers come from on studies, if they publish it at all.
And I would have put, my burger might have been good had they put it in the bag.
Yeah. Well, yeah, or we surveyed all the people that just bought a burger at McDonald's. Did say, is it your favorite burger? 87% of the people said it was. Really? I'm shocked. What? I would be concerned about the ones that said it wasn't after they just bought your burger. So the big deal on some of the questions is just having the division this year between covered entity and business associate. But the thing that I thought was really telling was the question that said, how was the data breach discovered? And so, you know, you've got multiple breaches occurring in all of the organizations. I don't think any of them had just one incident or breach, it based on what I was reading. However, the numbers, when you look at the top ways things were found, okay, in a covered entity, the top way it was found was an audit or an assessment, which is what you're supposed to be doing. Okay, so 69% of the breaches that occurred in the covered entity said they found a breach through an audit or an assessment. Great, you're doing the thing that we go out there and encourage you to do and help you do and tell you to do, because it's part of your compliance work that's ongoing.
So the audit worked.
So it worked. but only 49% of business associates found it that way. The number one way business associates found it is an employee detected it, which means somebody went, hey, why is that happening? It just stumbled on.
If that's encouraging or not.
I know. It's you know, it's 60% of the way that they were found. They say that that was it. Now, don't think that covered entities have it rolling, because that's the second most popular way that covered entities found it, was an employee detected it. So 44%. But what that reflects is you have to, in order to have that level of detection, that means employees were trained to notice it and bring it up. Mm-hmm. So that in itself, that's good news. That at least employees, so the system's working and everybody, employee training, if you do employee training and you do the audits and assessments, you will find them. Because the likelihood that you're not going to find them, the number three reason for business associates, and it's the number four reason for covered entities, is they accidentally stumbled on it.
So I thought that would be number one.
Yeah, they just accidentally stumbled on it, and that's how they found it. Well, it could be we did an audit after we realized we should be doing an audit, so we said we did an audit. Remember about the truthfulness. But we accidentally stumbled on it is the number three reason that business associates find it, and the number four reason that covered entities find it. Now, that's not saying a good thing for covered entities, because the number three reason that covered entities found it was a patient complaint. So that's not good.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So for a covered entity, it's an audit assessment, then it's employee detected it, then it's a patient complaint, and then we accidentally stumbled on it.
Wow.
Yeah. The good news is the audits and assessments, they work if you do them. If you train your employees to notice these things, it works, and they notice it and they report it before you have a bigger problem, which could result in a patient complaint. So if you're not doing it with one and two, it's happening with number three.
Or you could train your patients to notice you.
Well, you know, and people are training your patients. And that's another thing that people need to realize is that patients are starting to be trained in this by a variety of people because they're so concerned about these breaches that are occurring. I mean, I have people who come up to me in the classes where I'm teaching the employees about HIPAA in a covered entity or business associate, and they come ask me questions about dealing with the breach notifications they've received from other entities. So it's happening across everywhere, and people are going out and actively seeking advice on understanding this. And once it happens to them, then they're going to start asking their providers, are you taking care of this? And if you tell them yes, and then something happens, you've got a bigger problem.
Yeah, I've actually seen that several times in some social media forums where somebody will post, you know, is this a breach? And they'll go on to describe it. And inevitably, somewhere in there, it'll be, should I get a lawyer involved or should I sue them for this? I mean, you know, they're most of the time, they're not just looking to fix a problem you have. They're looking at whether or not they can file a lawsuit.
Yeah. You just don't know. Well, and remember that that next line item was they accidentally stumbled upon it. So, you know, there's your top four. Because, I mean, patient complaint, it's still a pretty high ranking number. On the business associates, it's employees detected it is number one. Number two is the audit and assessment. Number three is accidental. But here's the business associate. Number four is a legal complaint.
A legal complaint.
So it's not good.
I wouldn't think that most business associates would get a complaint from a patient because they don't deal directly with patients in most cases, I would think.
Yeah, but they may have rated it that way because their covered entity let them know.
Yeah, that's true.
So they do have, the next one would be patient complaint. But if you look at those reasons that they found it and the way that they found it, good news is they found it through audit and assessment, employee detection primarily. Bad news is everything after that is bad.
Yeah, you're right. So you got,
if you're not doing it, you're in trouble.
Yeah, and the first two are more proactive. So the more proactive you can be with your employees and training and audits and assessments, then the less likely you're going to have with the legal complaints and the law enforcement and patient complaints and accidental stuff.
Indeed. So there we go. We talked about the study. See, David, it was worth a conversation. All right.
All right. Very good. So until next time, let me remind everybody, head on over to iTunes and give us a review. And if you have a question, go to our website, helpmewithhipaa.com, and you can leave a question right there, either through our SpeakPipe widget, which is where you actually talk into it and leave us your voice question, and we will feature, or we may feature your question. How about that? Depending on how crazy it is, we may feature your question in a future podcast. And we thank everyone for listening.
You've been listening to the Help Me with HIPAA podcast, hosted by Donna Grendel and David Sims, the show created to help you with HIPAA. For more information or to ask us a question, visit our website at helpmewithhipaa.com. Neither Donna Grendel or David Sims are attorneys, and they do not offer binding legal advice concerning regulatory compliance. The information in this podcast should not be relied upon or construed as legal advice in any way. Consult your attorney for legal advice concerning compliance with HIPAA regulations.